Hello, everybody, and welcome to the last session of the next virtual summit. Hope you have enjoyed all the session our mates from External Connection, Max and Guillermo, have organized for us this week. And we will end with a session about social innovation. You know that it's a pillar of Next. It's Anna speaking. I am based in Barcelona, and I am the co-lead of social innovation together with my mate, Maria Tumareva. And today we will talk with three of our 15 scholars that we ran with the Zurich Foundation in the One Young World Conference. Maybe some of you will think, what is this, you know? What is One Young World Conference? One Young World, it's like the Olympic Games of the social project. So you can imagine the big meeting that it is. So it's a meeting of young people that want to change, you know, and solve problems that they face on their communities. And together next with the Zurich Foundation, this 2022, we give 15 scholarships for 15 scholars, and 12 that are external young people that are running social projects, and 3 for internal scholars, like employees of Zurich, that also have their own social projects out of Zurich. So we made a scholarship for them, and they attended virtually this year because of the COVID-19. But we have like very famous speakers last year in the One Young World. We have Angela Merkel, Paris Hilton, and it's an event that tries to inspire them, to give them ideas, and also to make a lot of networking with other young people that are doing the same things. So today, this session, our goal is that you can inspire of these three scholars that we have together here with us this afternoon or morning, wherever in the part of the world you are. So I will present you Tyler Sangaria, Arjun Misra, and Carla Godoy. Carla is based, she's from Brazil. Arjun Misra is based in India, and Tyler Sangaria is based in the US. So let's begin with you, Arjun Misra. I think we have it here. He's the founder of Navet India, and he's helping disabled people in his country. So Arjun, can you explain a little bit more how is your project about and what you are doing to help your community?
Thank you so much, Anna. Thank you for the wonderful introduction. And to everyone present, wish you a very good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whichever part of the world are you. I hope the audio is good. Someone can confirm. Can you guys hear me well? I hope the audio is good.
Yeah, Arjun, we hear you.
Thank you so much for confirming. So I'm the co-founder of an organization called Navet India. And this stands for the National Association for the Blind, Employment and Training. This is a social enterprise which is based in India, which works for the empowerment and education of people with disabilities. Max, if you could slip to the next slide, please. Thank you so much. So this has been the journey of NABIT. We started the organization in 2009. Disability in India is not only a stigma, it also leads to a lot of exclusion for the differently abled. A huge population of the country, approximately 2% of the country's population are people with disabilities. And when we started this organization, where they were considered compatible to be doing only menial jobs, and we have created a lot of transformation in their lives onwards in the last approximately 11 years of our service. If you see the first picture, from being taking up menial jobs like stitching, sewing, etc., to be now managing high-tech IT support services for leading organizations. That has been the contribution over the last 10 years that NABIT has provided. And more importantly, what we have helped in is changing the perception of the society towards people with disabilities from once when they were considered as a liability on their families and society at large to now being considered as a valuable asset and economically independent and a contributing member. I feel the dignity in the lives of the differently abled has been the biggest contribution that NABIT has delivered in its service of over 11 years. Max, the next slide, please. So if you guys notice on the screen in front of you, you would notice there's just one entry which is significantly different amongst all 10 entries. Often what happens is, it's the perception of the society that we chase perfection so much that the slightest of differences, the slightest of problems, may that be physical or mental, that a person faces, in a competitive world we live in, we choose to exclude and not consider the pain this person has suffered too. While it, yes, in a competitive environment, that's what Darwin also proposed, but that's not how living is. It's important for an organization, a society, or even as living as individuals. I believe the weakest link in the chain needs to be protected and provided an opportunity to grow. I think that represents the people with disabilities in my country for which I'm working for. It's just not one, two, it's about 2%, approximately 1.5 billion people worldwide, about 75 million people in India itself, which suffer from disability. And that is, and most of these people are dependent on grants and charities. This is something which we as NABIT were not comfortable with. We wanted to bring back the opportunities for employment in such people by identifying the skills, identifying or creating those proficiencies so that they could be considered as a contributing member of the society. Max, next please. So is it free or does it add value? I believe before we start, creating an asset, first we need to create the need for that asset. First, we need to speak about the advantages that that asset can deliver to society or whoever we would want to add it to. It's this part which we believed at a very early age when we started this organization. And we worked towards, even before reaching out to the industry or the society or government or anyone else, we tried to identify what is that skill set which we can deliver amongst the differently abled, which can cause them to be considered as an asset for the society. We started off by identifying IT support services, and I'll speak more about the journey of how we have developed around it and how we have transformed the differently abled lives. Max, next please. So how many number of people are we speaking about that we are supporting or contributing towards? This is the Sikh community in India, which attributes for a population which is actually equal to the population of the number of differently abled in India itself. We're talking about 75 million people. If you see the maps in front of you, that is actually almost the population of a continent like Australia. It's that big a number that we work towards. And what's astonishing is, of the 75 million people, the employment numbers contributes just about 15 to 20%. So statistically, what we're speaking about is that about 75 to 80% of the population are dependent on grants. Can we as a society be justified to overlook their pain? That was the question which NABIT wanted to cater to. Max, next slide, please. Just throwing some statistics because we all love numbers and the importance of stressing about the issue at hand. A 1.3 billion disabled population worldwide, 75% of them finding employment, 50% most among them live in poverty, and approximately 80% without a source of livelihood. These are numbers which glare for attention. Nearly 90% of them miss an opportunity to complete their formal education. 1.3 billion people are too large a number for us to overlook and ignore worldwide. Can we create some value? Can we create some skills amongst the differently abled and then scale this across the world so that they can then be considered as value promoters, and not only support their families, but be considered as an asset wherever they are from. Max, next slide, please. So this has been the impact which NABIT has delivered over the journey of last approximately 10 years. We worked with 1,600 people, differently abled with various kinds of disabilities. May that be orthopedically challenged, may that be visually impaired, may that be speech and hearing impaired. We've created employment for plus 70%, around 1,100 plus people have been employed in industries, and people with disabilities are hired from us not because of a sympathy attached to them. They are hired because the training which we provide and the skills which we create amongst them are such that they are then considered as assets for the companies which hire them. They are hired because the value they bring to the organization and not out of charity. We've also partnered across the country with 12 leading NGOs which align with our mission, and that helps in making our program more accessible to the end beneficiaries. I'm also proud to mention that we have over 7 leading listed companies, the likes of Amazon India, the likes of Mahindra Group, Tata Insurance, which outsource work to NABIT, wherein we provide them with IT support services, And we have been proudly been associated with them at times, even for more than 5 years now. The reason they outsource work to us is because of the dedication and the low attrition amongst our manpower, which becomes a great asset, especially for those industries wherein attrition is common and where attrition also becomes the decider of profitability, sustainability for the organizations. That's one organization, NABIT, which is doing this all. Talking about the industries where NABIT has been working in, where we started with IT support services, we gradually moved into retail. We have also started a program where trying to serve to the end beneficiaries, we have an in-house capability of manufacturing sanitary napkins for better women hygiene. We have people with disabilities involved in the different lives, in the life cycle of the product, may that be the packaging, may that be the distribution. Eventually, what we have created is a self-sustaining program wherein not only they get better inclusion amongst the beneficiaries, amongst the rural population, and also we created a profitable model where their salaries and the benefits are drawn from the proceeds, which comes to us from the sale of the products. Max, next slide, please. So the impact, we work across the agribusiness, we work in telecom, we work in IT, ITS. We have also started enterprises, which have been led by people with disabilities, 57 of them, disabled-led enterprises serving across multiple companies. Services like data entry services, IT support services, accessibility testing. These have been our ex-trainees who have started their own enterprises and are now serving proudly the best of the best in the industry. And can't stress more on the fact that they are hired because they bring value and they are as competitive in their offering, both in pricing and in quality as anyone else. And most importantly, we have created a just and an equitable society which works for, which values the contribution, and which cares for the weakest link, which we work for, which may be the people with disabilities. Max, next slide, please. Now, talking about the challenges which is faced by a person with disability and why are they considered excluded for such long before we came in midst of the program. Max, the next slide, please. There was a lot of stereotypes which are attached to a person with disability. More often than not, even without meeting the person, we first decide what kind of job roles can this person be adept for or then be considered for. Where this becomes a problem is often it's not the disability of the person itself, but it's our inability to see beyond the disability of the person which forces us to consider them fit for only those kind of job roles, such as initially talking about 10, 15 years back, they were considered only for cane making or for making chairs or menial jobs. I don't discount the contribution which was delivered, but I felt it was time that they were considered for more valuable job roles, which not only bring more economic prosperity for the families, but also helps them move up the value chain. Often they have the same level of aspirations in life, like you and I, and it's important for us to offer them the opportunity. Talking about the successes, I'm not sure if you're aware, the Paralympic Olympic Committee of India was ranked way better. We were the 20th position as compared to the peers of non-disabled. We had a phenomenal success at the recent Olympics. It just speaks that they always had the capability. All they required was an opportunity to be given the platform to perform. And I think that's been one of the contributors to that has been the work that we have delivered. So I think it's the change in the mindset which was required by the society. If you see the first picture, they were considered, now they started working on mobile repair works. They started working on advanced IT support roles. That happens to be the Indian cricket team, which at once had also won the World Cup. So this speaks about, of course, the popularity of cricket as a sport, but also speaks about the skills that these people have developed over the years and the confidence they have in their capabilities. Max, the next slide, please. Now, from a very business starting point, what is there for us as a business house and how do we gain from this? Talking about my experience, we have had the manpower which has been deployed on various projects. It's not easy for them to get an opportunity and they extremely value the trust that you lay in them. So what it offers to you as a business house is an attrition-proof mantra. Trust me, that's a great asset, especially if you're in a role from a B2C business, wherein you have end customers who interact with your team each day. It's the dedication, it's the years of experience, it's the pride which they take in the job that they perform. And I think that seriously, you know, the contribution which you make initially in training them, even the expenses that you incur, it hugely outweighs the productivity and the performance which they deliver to you through their hard work and effort. So that's a great value attrition. Also, second important point is when you develop a new talent pool, eventually that leads to trickle down of the prosperity. And once they aspire for a greater, better future, the economy grows, the society grows, it helps build bigger, better businesses and bigger businesses for you as an organization. So working towards their inclusion also helps in sensitizing your employees about the hardships which these people face. That sensitization also creates an atmosphere amongst your peers, which is worth imbibing. And I think that is also a business case to be considered for. That said, it comes with a set of challenges. It needs extra care and caution when you hire them. But eventually, trust me, that delivers a huge impact, not only for you as a business, and speaks about your care that you, it speaks about the concern that you have for this. And that also makes a lot of business sense. Max, next slide, please. Often, we have a lot of prejudice about the capabilities of the people. I just can't stress more about how they are no different in terms of their aspirations, in terms of the challenges which they have faced than us. It's just important for us to value what they can bring to the business and give them an opportunity to flourish to their capabilities. That's Max, the next slide, please. Talking about the biggest contribution that NABID has made, we have helped change the mindset of the handicap. And also the society and this institution, while at once, the people with disabilities used to be considered as they had their own inabilities that we cannot or we can do certain job roles. It's now that has changed over time. They have now been able to consider and be more explorative in their aspirations. And that's something which I think it's been a contribution of NABID. We have pioneered new concepts of self-sustainability in our efforts. That's happened because of the contribution of us. Max, the next slide, please. Talking about the recognitions, NABID has been the proud recipient of multiple awards. I was the Queen's Young Leader in the year 2018. I was awarded by the government of Bangladesh. I was awarded by the Duke School in Berlin. I was also a professional fellow of the US State Department. And I think the recognition just applauds and recognizes the need for creating more such enterprises in NABID in the future. Max, the next slide, please. The biggest contribution for any if a country needs to change, I think it's the businesses which needs to step up. That's been the story of India also. On the left, you have Jamshedji Tata, who was the first industrialist who believed in the idea of an independent country, the reason we have this today. Even for the society, if we want to change the present status of the people with disabilities, I invoke the business community who might be a participant in this program, who would be hearing, to look towards the cause of disability as a value contributor, and that's not out of sympathy. And I think there's a lot of good that can be delivered. That's about it. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Arjun. It was amazing what you have shared with us. You know, first the dramatic numbers of the, you know, disabled people, that 75% of them are not, you know, working or are not, you know, having the same opportunities like us. And I think that what you are doing there, you know, in your community for disabled people is amazing. The consultancy and also the training that you are doing for enterprises and the, you know, the change of mindset that you have said that you are doing, it's amazing. I think that your contribution, it's I hope it inspires our mates, and also here, you know, that in Zurich, we are very about diversity. We are very focused on that. So I think that it's a good story to know your project. Also, I remember everybody that you can, you know, ask questions to our scholars on the chat. So if you have any questions, we'll deal with all of them at the end of the our scholar's speech. So now let's go with Carla Godoy that we have here. And Carla, as I said, is from Brazil. She had a personal story that it's very touching because I think you were born in a favela in Brazil, but you have, you know, a family of women, that very powerful women that inspire you to make Ecociclo, the project that you are a CFO. So Carla, talk us a little more about Ecociclo. What is it about? Carla, you are on mute. You should activate your microphone. Yeah, no worries.
Hear me now?
Yeah, now yes. Perfect. Yes. Thank you, Carla.
Yes?
Yeah. No, you are on mute again. I don't know what happened. You are on mute, Carla. No. Now you are with the microphone activated.
Now it's worked.
Now it's good?
Yeah. Now it's
okay. Okay, perfect. I hope it stays like this.
No, it's not staying like this. Maybe it's because you have, you know, your presentation on the screen. So maybe, you know, you can activate your microphone and we will share this, you know.
Okay, now I think now you guys can hear me.
Yeah, now we can hear you.
Yes, okay. It works.
Can you guys see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Oh my gosh. Okay. So thanks so much for the introduction. And it happens with technology and everything. Like, okay, can you guys hear me? Can you guys see my screen? I think that's the most heard line throughout the pandemic. But today, my presentation is going to be about sustainability and caring about people, and how we approach sustainability as a strategy to create impactful business run by women. And to start my presentation, I'm going to pose two questions that someone posed to me 3 years ago when I was thinking about starting something to change people's lives. And that person asked me those questions, and I still ask myself those same questions every day. How can I impact the lives of millions of women, and how can I help people to be more sustainable? Because I think that it's so related one to those questions are so related to each other that I couldn't work with only one. And I'm gonna tell you guys how I learned how do I answer those two questions, and what lessons taught me and helped me to answer those questions. So the first lesson is understanding that community is nature. To be able to answer those two questions, I had to understand what my community needed, and that my community was part of a bigger thing about nature. So, and that's when I started presenting myself. So my name is Carla. I am from Brazil. I was born in one of the Brazilian favelas. I was born in Recife. I am that chubby baby in my mom's and grandma's arms. And I was always surrounded by fear, inequality, and lack of opportunities. Everything that kind of place, that kind of environment can provide to a woman. And I grew up around that, but I was lucky enough to be surrounded by strong women, by strong personalities that taught me how to pursue my dreams, how to help other women on my way pursuing my dreams, and to never give up. But learning, and also like throughout college and my first master's, I was like, can we really talk about sustainability around that kind of environment? When poverty is so strong, when people are worried about what they're going to eat and what they're going to do the next day to be sure that they can provide to their kids. And I was like, we cannot talk about sustainability without talking about poverty. We cannot talk about that without bringing these people together in that movement. So the first lesson taught me that I needed to bring my community with myself throughout anything that I would do in my life. So I didn't know what I was going to do. I didn't know how I was going to answer those questions. But the first thing that I knew was that anything that I would do, I would have to involve my community, my people, the women that raised me, the women that take care of my mom right now in Brazil while I'm here in the States. So that's the first lesson. The second lesson is that sustainability starts at home. And home can mean different things to everyone. And first of all, you have to understand what is home for you, what home means to you. And home for me means whatever I am, that I'm surrounded by friends and people that welcome me and that make me feel a better person. And I was lucky enough to have found my teammates, my those women, those wonderful women that accepted to answer those questions with me. So I found them when I was participating in a project, and we were like, okay, how can we answer those questions? How can we impact millions of women, and how can we help people to be more sustainable? And we came up with EcoCiclo. EcoCiclo is the first 100% biodegradable sanitary pad made in Brazil. It was developed by us for women who think that 1,000 of menstruate people that do not have access to basic hygiene products, they need to have access to it. And we accepted the challenge. We accepted the challenge to, at the same time as we are creating a sustainable option for people that menstruate, we are also reducing the impact that women produce just because they have periods. So just for you guys to know, a person that menstruates uses 10 to 15,000 sanitary pads during their lives. And one single sanitary pad takes up to 500 years to decompose. So it's like, it's too much trash just because we have something in our body, like it's part of our nature to have periods. And we decided to solve that. We decided to solve that problem and bring other women with us. So EcoCiclo is 100% biodegradable. It biodegrades in 6 months. We reduce the CO2 emission during the production if we compare normal sanitary pads and our sanitary pads. It's hyperallergenic, atoxic, and vegan. But most important, we employ women in vulnerable situations. So during our production, we are employing women from favelas in our production, and it's amazing because it's what I told you guys, like we are bringing the women that we grew up with to that movement, to that project, and we are seeing their lives change. And I think there is no better outcome or better there is no better feeling than seeing other women's lives changing based on something that you're doing, that you're helping them to achieve. And that's just a circle of women helping women to be more sustainable, to take care of their bodies, to take care of themselves, and also to achieve economic independency because they have that new kind of income. And that's how we work. So we provide sustainable livelihoods to those women. We work with a cyclical logistics. So during the, I'm going to explain that in a couple of seconds, but we have that cyclical logistics where we sell the pads to other women so they can sell to their friends, to their communities, so we can generate more and more and more jobs. We also have a learning community. So it's really interesting to see how women can get together to talk about health, talk about opportunities, empowerment when we want to. And that's also part of EcoCiclo, because we're not only producing and selling sanitary pads, we're also providing knowledge and opportunities to other women to get to know themselves. And that's how we connect women in the environment. That's how we we found to do that. That's our business model. We have a B2B and B2C, what I was talking about. So we have the pads, we sell to the intermediary, to women that are going to sell to their communities, but also we have a website where we can sell the pads directly to our clients, so it's a B2C. But I think like just only two lessons were not enough. We were seeing that we were doing something, but the change that we wanted to see was not coming too fast enough. So the third lesson is about sustainability is also taking care of people. It's understanding that you cannot talk about the environment and nature without understanding that people are also part of nature, that it doesn't matter where they're from, their background, anything, like it's also taking care of them. So thinking about that, and throughout the pandemic, we found that there are so many other women that produce sustainable products, but didn't have access to platforms, they didn't have access to ways to sell them, like throughout the pandemic, that we decided to create our own platform to help those women to sell their own products and to come with us in that process. So we were selling the pads in our website, and we thought, okay, let's do that with other women. Let's expand that so other women have access to the same platform that we have, and they can expand their business. They can keep earning their money throughout the pandemic. And it's really interesting because we created a community, like a marketplace community, where women go to our marketplace and find sustainable products produced by other women. And it's so interesting to see that happening because it's kind of natural. It just comes, and the empowerment that we can give to both women that produce the pads and also the women that sell in our marketplace, it's beautiful. So how it works, we select the women that wants to sell in our marketplace. We get them ready. We take pictures of their products. We teach them how to communicate the products on Instagram or whatever. We teach them logistics, everything that's related to the marketplace that they need to learn. And then they sign up to sell at our marketplace, and they're ready to take the word. They're ready to sell throughout Brazil and to expand their businesses. And just to give you guys a little bit about the business that we have in our marketplace. We have Caroline Oliveira. She's the founder of Acolhe. She produces homemade cosmetics at her house and sells in her community and also in the state of Salvador. This is the other one is Nicole Lima. She is the founder of Oi Flor, and she produces things related to earth, to organic produces and flowers and everything that makes your home beautiful. And it's really touching. It's really cute. And I skipped one and I don't know how to go back, but just bear in mind that I had other two that I was going to show, but I can go back, but it's okay. We have Motai also. She's a chemical engineer. So we see that we have amazing women in our marketplace, like amazing entrepreneurs that are present in our marketplace. It produces natural and vegan cosmetics. We have Folha Dourada. She is the founder of a black owned manufacturer for ancestor like wisdom and healing products. It's really interesting. And after those three lessons, I can say that I have the answers ready for those two questions, but I think that I'm starting to get them answered, and I'm so excited to see what the future brings, but it's waiting for us, and what else we can do to keep helping and impacting the lives of other women and helping more people to be more sustainable. And just to finish, I would like to present my team. I wouldn't be here, like we wouldn't be in the stage that we are without Ellen, without Adrieli, and without Patricia. They're all in Brazil right now, and I miss them so much, but we still work really, really great being online, and yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Carla. I think that the answer for the two questions you said at the beginning of your, you know, speech and at the end is like you are impacting, I think, lives, and you are also making, you know, that we are more sustainable because you are not only doing, you know, the eco part, so you are bringing the opportunity for the other women to be sustainable. So I think that your impact is like multiplied. So congratulations, Carla. This is why you are also a scholar of our scholarship, because we like also your project. So now I think it's the last one that we have Tyler Sangaglia here. I remember, Tyler, that I read an interview about you, and you said that your father always said to you that you should do the thing that you like the most and then be the best to do it, right? So I think that, well, you are the founder of the Hope Festival. So can you, you know, explain a little bit how it is about the Hope Festival? Tyler, your turn.
Yes, hi, Anna. Thank you so much. Thank you all so much for the opportunity to be here. I'd love to talk a little bit more about Hope Fest. So my name is Tyler, and today I'm going to be talking a little bit about engaging the next generation of youth in service and a little bit about the work that my friends and I have done through the Hope Festival. So like Anna mentioned, my name is Tyler. I'm from Seattle, Washington in the United States. A little picture there in the bottom left for you. I love Washington State. I've been there my entire life. And my family and friends are everything for me. My family's up there in that picture in the top left, and my friends down there in the middle. They're absolutely incredible. I love them all so much. And I'm a senior in university at a school called Gonzaga, also in Washington State. And another fun fact about me is I love to travel. And that picture on the far right is from the incredible opportunity I had to travel to Munich, Germany, to go to the One Young World Conference, all thanks to Zurich, and Next this past July. So a huge thank you to you guys for that opportunity. So my community service journey kind of all starts 7 or 8 years ago in the Seattle, Washington area with this wonderful woman named Kim. And Kim is amazing, but she definitely thought my friends and I were a little bit insane when we first met her. She is a local community member who oversaw some of the spaces that we had these big ideas and big dreams to do these service projects in. And she thought we were a little crazy for these big ideas we were having. She was definitely someone who doubted us a little bit, wasn't sure what a bunch of 14, 15-year-olds could really do with these big ideas, but she ended up being one of the biggest motivating factors starting off. So going a little bit more into my service journey, so Seattle, Washington in the U.S. has the third largest homeless population among cities in the United States, so it's a massive problem for us. And about 7 years ago, my friends and I decided we wanted to do something about this. We got together, we wanted to take action. We saw kind of the need firsthand for the first time in our lives. And what we came up with was this idea to create a one-stop shop service event that would basically provide under one roof all the tangible supplies, resources, and services for anyone who is in need in the area. And we called this event Hope Fest. And so when we started off, we had this idea and we wanted to do it. We made it happen after years worth of planning with a few friends. We had this small group of high school friends that came together and peers who made it happen. And we were able to serve a few hundred families. We offered things like groceries. We had clothes for kids and for adults. And we even had books for anyone who came as well. And after this first year of spending all this time making this event happen, we were like, okay, you know, we're onto something. We proved to ourselves that we were able to do it, and we really wanted to see if we could take it to the next level. So in 2016, we became a nonprofit organization, and we really wanted to keep going bigger. So we got a few more of our friends involved and started offering even more supplies and things to those who need our event. We offered hygiene supplies. We offered toys for the kids. Every single kid got to walk away with a brand new toy. We even had raffles where we could raffle off brand new bicycles for both kids and adults, as well as TVs and brand new laptops. We partnered with several organizations and agencies in the area who could come and provide more long-term support to those in need after the festival, whether it was through support with domestic violence or mental health issues, they could provide that more long-term care. We had services like haircuts and even dental care, where no insurance was required, no questions asked. Even up until this past year in August, we were able to offer COVID vaccinations for the first time, as well as health screenings. We were able to offer entirely free vision screenings and hearing screenings. We even partnered with our local Humane Society to bring in a bunch of kittens to come play with the kids. It was amazing. And while all these kind of tangible resources and services are what bring people in, one of the things that we really focus on as an organization is making sure people walk away with a sense of hope. Again, while they come for the clothes and the groceries, those things run out. And what we hope doesn't run out is this understanding that everyone who comes is cared for by their community, no one's forgotten, and that we are all here to support them. So as again, we kept going after 2016, we kept holding events and we got more of our friends and more of our high school local youth involved year after year and kept getting a little bigger each time. And it was, you know, for me, one of the most incredible aspects of doing this work has been just being able to engage so many other young people in our work. Even up until, again, this past August, when we had our most recent Hope Festival event, where we had to kind of reinvent everything we've ever known how to do. And we were able to safely execute a COVID-safe event during the summer, which is something that, you know, is difficult for many nonprofits to operate in their work. So this was a proud moment for us for sure. So over the years, we've run 6 festivals, served over 8,000 individuals through the power of 2,500 youth volunteers. And we've been so fortunate and blessed to have more than 200 partner organizations, over $90,000 raised in grants and sponsorships, and more than 17,000 kilograms of clothes and food donated through projects even outside of the Hope Festival event itself. So you might be familiar with this concept of the golden circle, which basically states that organizations and people, you know, what we do all starts with our why. Why we're doing what we're doing is the most important piece. And so focusing on Zurich and Next, we know what that why is. The why of Next is engaging the next generation of youth, creating an intergenerational dialogue, and ensuring that the next generation is ready to kind of take over and address some of the world's most pressing issues. So today what we go into a little bit is more of the how. How do we engage the next generation and get these incredible young people ready to do the work? And when I thought about what's worked for us over the past few years, having engaged hundreds and so many youth, I broke it down in kind of these 4 sections. The first is to inspire young people. A second is to target their passions. The third is to cultivate leadership, and then kind of tying this all together with the idea of corporate support through incredible corporations such as Zurich. So starting out with inspiration, I love this picture of us. It's myself and some friends on a freezing cold morning outside our storage unit before we're running one of our Hope Fest events. And that man in the front, his name is Sun. He is one of my biggest mentors. He's someone who's been there since day one. He's a refugee from Vietnam who left on the last day of the war on the second to last ship to leave the country. And he's now built, you know, an incredible life for himself, giving back and doing good here in the US. But he was someone who, you know, when my friends and I were 14 and 15 years old and had this idea, who was really the first person to take us under our wing and say, you know what, I think you'd be good at this. I think you can do this. Let's make it happen. And for me, that's really where it all started, was that inspiration of seeing someone doing the work and having him say, you know, I think you could do this too. So breaking down this idea of inspiring young people to get involved a little bit further, the first key element that I think of is making service social. You know, I think too often we have this idea that community service is standing outside a grocery store, collecting cans or folding clothes in a cold, dark room. And while both those things are great, that's not what service has to be. Service should be fun, exciting. It should be a party, you know, it should be with groups of friends. And so service should always be social and something fun. Again, I kind of mentioned this, but the power of having an adult or someone that youth look up to saying, I think you'd be good at this, the power of a referral. That's something incredibly empowering for any young person to hear. It can really go a long ways. The third, and maybe this seems obvious, but just sharing stories of other young people who are doing good and being the change that they wish to see and showing that young people what they are capable of and telling other young people, this can be you. You can make this happen. And finally, the idea of purpose. You know, I know for me, especially in middle school and high school, I really needed something besides school to wake up to every day. And for me, this community service work, being part of something greater than myself, gave me that sense of purpose that I needed. So going into the second aspect is targeting passions of young people. This is my friend Ben and I. Ben used his passion of filmmaking and making videos to share our story of our community service work through many videos and being on the news. And again, just an idea of whatever youth's passions are that those can be used for doing good in the world. So breaking this down a little further, there's this movie called Rushmore with Bill Murray from 1999. And in the movie, Bill Murray asks the main character, Max, this question. He says, you know, Max, you're a pretty happy guy. You seem to got pretty figured out. You know, what's the secret to your happiness? And Max responds by saying, I think you just got to find something you love to do and do it for the rest of your life. I think that's a pretty good quote. I really like that one. And what it connects to is the idea that, you know, very rarely are, you know, whether it's young people or adults, people who succeed and who thrive are rarely doing something they don't love. You know, it's what we love to do and what we're passionate about is what we thrive in. And this is the same thing for young people. It's the idea that we should be finding what young people are passionate about, whether it's performing or playing an instrument or playing a sport, and making the connection that that can be used to do good as well, whether it's getting involved with a local youth group or, you know, mentoring someone for free, whether they're a kid in need or anything like that. Whatever youth's passions are, they can be used for doing good. And that just comes back to breaking the norms of what service really is. Going off of that is meeting youth where they're at, and again, showing what how those passions can be used to do good. You know, whether it's absolutely anything, these standard ideas of collecting food or sorting clothes are great, but it can be whatever youth's passions are, can truly be used to do something good in the world. And then finally, mentorship and starting, you know, whether it's whatever the project may be, and I still find this to be true for me today, is the hardest part is always getting started and taking that first step. So having powerful adult mentors there to mentor through those first steps is an incredibly impactful part as well. Moving into the third aspect of getting our next generation of youth involved in service and giving back is this idea of cultivating leadership. I love this picture. This is at one of our Hope Festival events, and it's just a bunch of my friends in our Hope Fest shirts who are running the show. One of my favorite aspects is a lot of people don't really understand that when we're doing these events, these are the group of people in charge. There's no adults overseeing us or telling us how it's going to go or what should be done. It's literally just these group of kids. And I think a lot of people think we're crazy for that, but I love that because it just shows what youth are truly capable of. And when, you know, breaking down this idea of cultivating leadership a little bit further, it means granting project ownership and the agency to lead to young people. I think when you really empower youth, going, you know, this is you, you're owning this, whatever project you're taking on or, you know, giving back that you're going to lead, like, you're running the show. You don't need anyone else to make this happen. And again, kind of detailing this a little bit more, it means granting creative freedom for projects that kids want to take on, breeding the ability to fail and letting youth know that they really will learn from the things that go wrong. Embracing the no's. I still love getting told no. I truly have learned to love it because the more that we get told no, the more it makes us want to prove whoever wrong and show, you know, like, we can make this happen. And then finally, setting difficult goals, you know, setting goals that aren't easy, but, you know, empowering youth by going, I really think you can make this happen. Let's dream big and let's find a way to bring those ideas to life. And then finally, just tying all these three kind of main aspects together with the idea of corporate support and what organizations like Zurich and like Campaigns Through Next can really do to, again, continue to increase the power of young people. This picture is from an event called We Day and is, in my head, one of the best ideas and demonstrations of corporate support. A bunch of corporations coming together to celebrate what young people are doing in the community through different speakers and performances. It's a really powerful, impactful day, and it just stands out to me as a great example of corporate support. And when I break down this idea of corporate support a little bit more, I think there's kind of two main facets to what corporations can do for young people. The first is service and advisory, and this is kind of the idea of corporations overseeing and providing more overarching support. And the second being service and partnership, which is really doing the work with young people. So starting with service and advisory, again, this is like the idea of mentorship and funding, whether it be through grants or micro grants, and supporting and making connections throughout the community or providing help scaling. This type of corporate support is one that's kind of overarching and really utilizes the power of a big corporation like Zurich, for example, to increase the power of whatever youth want to get done. And then second, for service and partnership, this is really serving at eye level. This is getting down and dirty and going in with youth to support their projects, serving alongside them, supporting in the planning and execution of whatever those projects may be, and finding collaborative solutions to the issues that they want to address. It's really just the idea of doing that work together. And I think ultimately what it comes down to for corporate support is it means brand benefit overall from a business perspective. You know, it's engaging a whole demographic of people who you otherwise might not have. For example, me, my connection to Zurich, you know, an insurance company out of Switzerland is something you wouldn't expect. But of course, now I have this incredible tie to this incredible corporation. All my friends know about it here in the US, and, you know, you never would have had that connection otherwise. So it's really good. Think from a brand perspective as well. So to conclude, for getting youth up next, the three key elements to doing so are inspiring, targeting the passions of young people, cultivating leadership and giving them ownership, and then ultimately utilizing the incredible networks through corporations like Zurich to do good. And when I look back 7-8 years later, I think again back to where it started with this wonderful woman named Kim, who now we're very close, thinks we're a little less crazy, still definitely a little bit, but she's been able to see a lot of what we've been able to do. And I think one of the things that has shown her, you know, that we were serious was our ability to engage other young people, get them involved, to give back in service, doing just those things. So a huge thank you to Zurich and Next again, not only for the opportunity to travel to Germany this past July, but for the opportunity to be a part of your incredible summit and really just to get to know the amazing people in your organization more. I so greatly appreciate the opportunity. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Tyler. Well, for all the things you've done on your community with the Hope Fest, and you know that you are helping low-income families and also homeless people, but also for your advices that you have given to us, you know, so young people from the Next community, if you want to run a social project, you have seen that it's fun because when Tyler explained it, it's like fun, you know, so I really like it, Tyler. So we have still like 6 minutes for questions. We have some questions. A lot of comments on the chat, for example, one that says, so powerful, thank you for your work in making such a huge impact to all our three scholars here. But also a question for you, Arjun, I think you are here. And they say, what an amazing impact is Navet making? Congratulations. If you will get confirmed about a big donation tomorrow, what will be top youth on your list to use the donation for?
Okay, so if I understand it correctly, if there was a big grant given, where would I utilize it? Significantly, I would, if among my top priorities, number one would be employment. I'm a very firm believer of the idea that economically empower a person, eventually you solve many of the societal problems along with that. So would extensively work towards sustainable ventures, which can eventually for generations solve the problem of poverty for the disabled people I serve. That's one. Second, I want them to be more aspirational in their education also. So if I could do that, I would want them to not discontinue the education post 12th grade, rather go ahead and complete their post-graduation if that could permit. Yeah, that would be my two top priorities. And of course, if I had the leverage, I would concentrate more on the rural folks versus those living in the urban places.
Thank you, Arjun, for answering the question. I have more comments, but well, it's like congratulating you. How wonderful it is to hear, for example, Carla, Latin American women like you who show so much enthusiasm and great conviction with the sustainable mission and the role of women in society. It's very inspiring. Congratulations. So congratulations, Carla. More comments, absolutely fantastic. We have here another question that maybe the three of you can answer. It says, so powerful. Thank you for sharing these great stories. What advice will you give to people who are keen to start their businesses, social innovation enterprises with an impact? Where should they start? Well, Tyler, at least share a lot of advices, but I don't know if Carla, June or Tyler, do you want to give more advices in this sense?
Yeah, sure. I can just give a couple other things that come to mind first. I think the first thing would be, again, I kind of mentioned the idea of taking the first steps is always the hardest part. And what comes down to me, you know, whether it's we're trying to start a new initiative or, you know, you're starting a new business or organization overall, it's always just getting the right team of people with you. So, you know, surrounding yourself with the right people. I think, again, that the best work is always done when you have more hands and more heads coming together to think through solutions together. So I would say, you know, first, finding the right group of people. And second, just leaning on your networks and people in the community who can provide that helping hand. Another thing I kind of mentioned was that idea of how mentorship and starting out is so important. And I think, again, leaning on your networks and leaning on people who are, you know, in established circles and, you know, who have done the work already is a key element of just taking inspiration, taking advice and learning. And I'd say that's important getting started. And then I guess kind of one more final thing would be, again, just embracing the no's, embracing the parts where things go wrong and when you fail. It sucks in the moment, but ultimately you can use that and turn it around and use it as motivation to do more and kind of make those big ideas come to life. So those are three things I would say.
I would say I have two comments about that. I think the first one is finding a problem that you're passionate about and that you really want to solve. So better to, like, more than finding a way to solve the problem, you have to be passionate about the problem itself, because it doesn't matter how you're going to find a way to solve it. Like, it might change over time, but if you are passionate about solving the problem that you're trying to solve, it doesn't matter how you're going to do it. You're just going to do it, and that's it. And for women that want to start something and don't know where to start or how to, I would say that don't give up. We need more women. We need more. We need to see more women out there to inspire and to make other women sure that we can take those roles. We can be in those positions.
Thank you so much, Carla, Tyler. Arjun, I don't know, you have activated your microphone.
Should I answer that also, or is it just for the two?
No, it's for the three of you. So if you want, if you have any advice, can.
I can speak for myself. You know, the initial part of a social entrepreneur's journey, before even the slightest of external support or motivation comes, is pretty lonely. So in the journey of that 10 years, I remember the initial 4 or 5 years, it is in all sanity, it's okay to quit, because you're forced under so much of pressure to perform, and it won't be rewarding that, you know, your mind will question your coming back each day to come back with the same force that you started the very first day and the same enthusiasm. So you should have the persistence to stick with your mission. And I think that's more important. The rewards do come in, but for you to be lasting that journey, I think, is rewarding in itself. And I think that's the biggest strength that you need to have.
Thank you so much, Arjun, also for advice. Your advice, I think that all the advices that you say to us are very useful and very important. You know, you should like what you do, but also, you know, have a lot of resistance, persistence, because you don't have success the first day. So yeah, it's a lot of passion and a lot of work what you have done and what you have achieved already. So, well, I think that we are finishing this session of the Virtual Summit, the last one. I have here with me Max and Guillermo. So, first, I wanted to thank you to the three scholars that are here with us, Carla, June, Tyler. Thank you so much for sharing your stories and your social projects and also your advices with the next community. And I don't know, Max and Guillermo, if you want to close, because this is the last session of the Virtual Summit. I leave you, the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you, Anna, and thank you also to Carla, Arjun, and Tyler. It was a really great session and a very perfect ending for our next virtual summit. Thank you to those who joined our summit the last week. We hope you enjoyed the session and that you will stay in contact with us. Guillermo, I will switch to you.
Thank you, Max, and thank you to all of you, all of the speakers that we had this year in the virtual summit. I think that all of them were amazing. So it was a real pleasure to organize this virtual summit with all of you. And I hope to see you in the next year with new ideas, new topic, and of course, trying to bring about change. So thank you very much, and I hope to see you soon.